We're back with another tutorial, and it's all about FCPX 3D Portrait. This tool is great for turning a flat photograph of a face into a dynamic 3D projection, perfect for documentaries, presentations, or any video. In this tutorial, we'll show you how to apply this tool and achieve your own three-dimensional portrait from start to finish. Let's get started. First, you'll need a portrait image. Here's how to choose the ideal portrait image for this tool. To get the best results, use photos where the subject is looking straight ahead into the camera. The more the subject tilts their head, or the more obstructions over the face, the less reliable the results may become. Whenever possible, use a higher resolution photo. More pixels provides more data for the tool to interpret. Any aspect ratio can be used. For spacing, it's recommended to have a lot of space between the face and the corners of the original image. Transparency in the background of an image may interfere with the rendering of the background of the 3D mesh. The tool is designed to create a 3D mesh from a photo of a human face, so unfortunately, no dogs or other non-human creatures can be accurately analyzed. Lastly, it can only be used to analyze a single face at a time, so a photo of a group cannot be used within this plugin. Now let's get back to our portrait. Make sure it's imported in your current library. Optionally, you can apply it to the timeline, like so. Then apply the 3D portrait tool to the timeline. And select it to see the inspector controls. First, let's check out the instructions button. It will pop up with an explanation of how to use this plugin anytime you need a refresher. In the instructions, we'll find guidelines for choosing the best possible image to use with this plugin. Use this middle drop-down to skip to any page. To close out the window, select the X button. Now let's begin by selecting the Apply Photo Here drop zone. We'll select our portrait image in the timeline. Then we'll select Apply. Below that control, we'll see a few controls for adjusting position and scale so that we can make sure that the full face of our subject is visible and positioned where we want it. For example, Media Pan adjusts the position of the media. And Photo X and Y position work almost the same way, except they move the entire layer, not just the media. Our photo is pretty centered, so we'll go ahead and decrease the scale of the photo until the full face is visible from top to bottom. Next, we'll navigate down to the Edit Mode controls. And let's get the party started. We'll hit the Detect Face button to analyze the facial features and create a point map of the face. Wait a minute. This might happen, and it's not a cause for concern. If the face doesn't detect at first, it may be due to the face not being large enough, so scale it up if necessary. And let's try that again. Success. We'll see this mesh appear, indicating the landmarks of the face: eyebrows, eyes, nose bridge, nostrils, and lips. In case you want the plugin to generate more possibilities before it detects a face, you can increase the Fitting Iterations control. First, we'll clear the data. Then we'll increase fitting iterations from 5 to 10. Then let's hit Detect Face again. Depending on our specs, it may take a bit longer before we see the result. The result may be the same as before, but it at least confirms that this is the best iteration possible. With these points, the plugin generates a mesh used for the 3D projection.
Amazing, right?
Once we have the face detected, we can adjust the mesh in a few ways. One way is that we can select individual points and drag the red arrow horizontally or the green arrow vertically. We can also hold Shift and drag over a group of points to select multiple at once. And we can use these arrows to reposition the group.
Now,
let's check out our 3D projection results. We'll show you how. Change the control mode to display 3D rotation OSC to hide the display points. Navigate to face controls. And we can check on 3D projection. As we can see, the tool has created a 3D projection of the original face. We can use the on-screen control to rotate around the mesh. Incredible! We've turned a flat image into a 3D shape. How cool is that? Now let's explore how to adjust the frame of the mesh creating the projection. We'll navigate down to the mesh controls. First, we'll turn on Show Mesh Wireframe, and we'll see what's underneath while we edit. Let's look closer at the mesh adjustment. We can adjust the position and size of all of the points, which will adjust the mesh for the 3D projection. For example, Mesh X Position, which is a horizontal move. Mesh Y Position, which is a vertical move. Mesh X Scale, which widens the mesh. Mesh Z Rotation, which adjusts the angle of the mesh. And Mesh Z Scale, which adjusts the depth of the mesh. Once finished, we'll uncheck Show Mesh Wireframe. As we edit, we can select the 3D projection checkbox on again to check our work. Optionally, we can continue to refine our 3D projection using the additional controls below. For some of these, we'll compare it with the mesh wireframe on or off, so it's easier to see the changes. Shape weight adjusts certain aspects of the mesh, which affect the look of the gender, ethnicity, and age, among others. Let's see a comparison. How interesting! Expression weight adjusts certain aspects of the mesh, which affect the look of the expression, whether the original portrait is happy, angry, or sad. Let's see a comparison. It's a very slight difference, so it's all up to your preference. Extrude distance is meant to be used when toggle shoulders is turned off. It pushes the contour of the mesh's head and pushes it backward in Z space to hide the gaps between the mesh and the original image. Toggle shoulders toggles or hides the mesh shoulders as well as the back half of the head. This works well for bald people. Let's see a comparison. Toggle ears toggles or hides the mesh ears, so we can choose to toggle it on if it better fits our final result. A lot of times, it may look best if we keep it off and allow the ears in the original to remain as is, so it depends on the situation. Adjust smile tweaks the lip shape of the mesh result. At the moment, we can't see too much of a difference, so we'll come back to it after open and close mouth. Open and close mouth adjust the openness of the mesh mouth. The default value treats the mouth as closed, so we may need to adjust it if our subject's mouth is open. It looks great so far, so we'll move on to the next step, rotating our 3D projection. As we've seen, we can use this on-screen control to rotate the 3D projection. We can also find these on-screen controls in the inspector under Transform Controls, X Rotation, and Y Rotation.
Rotation X rotates the media along the X axis. Rotation Y rotates the media along the Y axis. In addition, if we want to create an animation with this new 3D projection, we can set keyframes on the X and Y rotation parameters. To create an animation, add a keyframe by selecting the diamond next to any parameter. This will set the first keyframe at the playhead location. Then move to a different frame in the timeline and make an adjustment to that parameter to create an animation from one frame to the next. Check out the linked video below for more details on how to create animations with keyframes. And let's look at our results.
It makes a big difference.
The camera controls also contain controls for adjusting the viewing angle of the face, and they can also simulate different camera adjustments for bringing your footage to life, such as camera position, which adjusts the position of the camera view. Camera rotation, which changes the rotation of the camera view. Focal length, which adjusts the angle of view of the camera. Depth of field, which applies blur to objects outside the range of focus. Focus distance, which is the distance from the camera where the subject is completely focused. And sensor height, which adjusts the height of the camera lens. So far, we've covered how to create a 3D projection from a static portrait. We've learned how to adjust the 3D projection, and now we know how to animate it. But we're not done yet. Let's find out further how to customize our results, starting with light controls. We have a few light controls that can affect our mesh, and we can adjust their individual intensities and colors to achieve a result that fits our project. The two main lights are ambient or directional light, and the point light is supplementary. First, the ambient light adjusts the general light of the mesh. Intensity increases the brightness of the light. Directional lighting type is currently set to none, but we can select a different type of lighting to affect our mesh and create a different feeling. For example, diagonal left, medium right, above, diagonal right. For other lighting types, you may need to adjust the intensity to make it look more real. Point light adjusts the ambient and directional light so that it's more focused on a center point. Below that, we have additional controls for customizing the point light, such as intensity, width position, we can adjust the horizontal position of the light. And the vertical position of the light. Fall off start determines the size of the fall off. Fall off determines the spread of the fall off for the point light. With these controls, we can help establish a stronger focal point and can hide unwanted background elements in the final result. Metalness and roughness both adjust the way the light behaves. Metalness adjusts how the 3D projection will interact with the light. Roughness changes the texture of the surface, working with metalness to adjust the way the light will reflect. Play around with them until you like the result. Apply lighting to background is an option to apply our lighting setting to the background of the mesh. apply lighting to overlays won't work until we have an overlay on, so we'll come back to this. Next, let's look at the background controls. First, now we are using the original image background, but we can choose to uncheck it. This will set our background to a color or gradient that we can set. Before we move on, though, we'll scroll up and check on the shoulders and ears. Here's how they look. And let's scroll back down. The color displayed behind the projection can be adjusted with the color controls. You can also add a gradient to the background. Next, let's look at the overlay controls. Overlay lets us apply up to 2 overlays to our result. You could add other images, textures, or effects such as dust or smoke. For example, we could apply pixie dust as an overlay.
It makes a big difference.
Next, with these controls, we can composite the layers. We can adjust the position of the layer. And the size of the layer. As well as how the layer reacts with layers below. For example, lighten seems to work well in this situation. And we can adjust the transparency of the layer. And here's how it looks if we check on Apply Lighting to Overlays. Now that we're an expert on this plugin, here's the final result.
Just look at how dynamic that is. Now you know exactly what to do, and we can't wait to see the videos you make.